What's something about gravity that most physicists hold as an assumption that you think is deeply mistaken?
Okay, that's a good one. And I'm going to have most physicists against me now. Okay, maybe there are two things which are probably related. The first one is the assumption that general relativity and our understanding of gravity as we have it at the moment is based on Einstein's principles, which are the pillars of modern science, the pillars of general relativity related to the equivalence principle. And I think, and related to symmetries. And I think actually those, we don't need to have those pillars. I think you can derive the laws of gravity. You can derive general relativity, not based on additional assumptions and principles per se, but rather on the requirement that it is a self-consistent theory, that it is a stable theory, particularly when you embed it in a quantum field theory network. And you can actually derive general relativity from the ground up, and therefore you have the Einstein's principles as consequences of stability and self-consistency, as opposed to use them as original assumptions. So that's probably one of them. Uh-huh. Another thing which perhaps most of my direct colleagues would completely agree with, but as a whole, the general audience may think they disagree, although I think they would agree overall, is the notion that gravity, as described by general relativity, is not a force. You may have heard that, and people say that. They emphasize a lot the difference between our representation and our understanding of gravity with other forces of nature. And I think actually that is sometimes misleading, because for many aspects, general relativity is actually a force like the other forces of nature. And we can describe general relativity as a force. And we actually, the detection of gravitational waves is the proof that deep down gravity is a force. The gravitational waves is a representation through the stretching and squeezing of space-time of the force that is hidden within gravity.
Okay, well, firstly, what are those symmetries you think that we can do away with when deriving general relativity? And then also, what is the definition of force?
That's a good one. Definition of force, it's a very hard one. Let me start with what I think is simpler, although maybe the words themselves are not as simple. What are the symmetries that general relativity, according to Einstein, is rooted within? It's a beautiful symmetry, which is, the technical term is perhaps coordinate transformation invariance. It is a nonlinear diffeomorphism. That's the technical term. But actually, that symmetry in its sense is very simple to understand. It is the realization that the laws of physics should be equivalent wherever we are. And however we describe a phenomenon, it should be equivalent independently of the observer. So whoever you are, even though some elements are relative to one another, when it comes to measuring a physical quantity, we have to be able to describe it the way Einstein phrased it, is in any frame of reference. So independently of how you decide to represent nature around you, however you decide to slice space and time, that shouldn't matter. That is your own prejudice. But then ultimately, when you come with something which is physically observable, we should all agree on that. And that is a beautiful symmetry. It is a philosophical framework, if you want, in some sense. But to my mind, this is actually so beautiful. It's something that is derived from the self-consistency of a theory, as opposed to setting it up as the basis, as the foundations upon which we're going to build general relativity. So that was the first question about symmetry. The second question about what is a force? What do I mean by a force? I may get very deep to a point where I may not, you know, terminology and vocabulary is not my strength. So what do we mean by a force? I think for most of us, for me including, we think of force as a contact force in itself. When I push against something, that's a notion of pressure. In itself, that's not really a force per se. It's more related to the electromagnetic bonds, etc. But that's not exactly what we mean by force, particularly not when we're dealing with the gravitational force. So if you feel you're sitting down, for instance, if you feel your chair and the bottom of your chair, this is not the gravitational force acting on you. This is the pressure and the contact interaction that is present between the cells in your body and the atoms on the chair. And actually, that's related. That's very interesting. I'm going to attention, but that's related to Pauli's exclusion principle, which prevents two states, for instance, two fermions, two electrons, to occupy the same place at the same time. And so if we have already some of the states in the chair that are occupying a particular place at a particular time, I cannot just go through it. And so I'm feeling the effect from the pressure of this Pauli exclusion principle, which prevents me from having two states at the same place at the same time. That is not what I mean by a force at the more fundamental level, which I more represent as something related to electromagnetism, for instance. I consider electromagnetism to be a force, and it is something that can act at a distance. So it's not something of a contact, it's something that can act at a distance. And we may be familiar with that with a magnetic force, for instance. If you take a magnet, and you go again to take two magnets together, if they you switch them side, switch them poles, then they will attract each other, or they will repulse each other. And you can attract some iron with a magnet at a distance. That is happening through an electromagnetic force. And deep down, what happens is that there's a field there. This electromagnetic field that carries the force for us. And that can be represented fundamentally in a particle, in a field theory level. For us, we understand the electromagnetic force as being carried by a messenger, which we call the electromagnetic waves, or which we call deep down the photon. The photon is a messenger for the electromagnetic force. And gravity can be represented as a force in exactly the same way. So you may have heard of gravity, according to Einstein's theory of relativity, is not a force, rather it is the representation of the curvature of space-time. And that is an extraordinary, beautiful and accurate description of gravity for all sorts of phenomena. But it doesn't mean that also deep down, it isn't represented as a fundamental force, just like electromagnetism. And so if we feel the gravitational attraction from the Earth, it is also mediated by a gravitational field, which is carrying a force. And fundamentally, the component of this gravitational field is a particle, which we call the graviton. And there's a direct analogy there between electromagnetism being a fundamental force carried by photons and gravity, which is also a fundamental force that's mediated by gravitational field and carried by a fundamental particle, which we call the graviton.
Okay, so for the people listening, to go back, the general in general relativity comes from the theory being generally covariant, which is the same as being diffeomorphism invariant. So can you have general relativity if you remove that any coordinate system is an okay coordinate system? Isn't the whole point of the language of bundles to describe constructs without reference to coordinates? So then do you remove the underpinnings of differential geometry to GR?
So you don't want to do that directly, first of all, because general relativity is a beautiful framework that works extremely well in all sorts of settings. So as soon as you start removing some of the beauty of it directly, then you end up with elements which won't match observations. And as you said, it is a beautiful symmetry. It is also something that we like to have in a theory of, in a description of the world, where we would like to make abstraction as much as possible to anything which relies on us making a choice of any sort. And so in the world of bundles or in different representation of general relativity, we can abstract ourselves from expressing where we are in a frame of reference. However, there are some situations where we can think of a description of gravity, which is very well described by general relativity, up to a given level, but comes a point where this symmetry or this representation needs to have more to it. In reality, what happens is that you never break things completely. You never break everything down, but you start seeing a new structure emerging when you deep dive into it. But to understand how to do that, you first need to embrace all of the beauty of general relativity, you need to understand how it works, and only in some special limit can you allow yourself to go beyond that and understand a generalized framework that has a symmetry in some limit, but then more generally, it behaves slightly differently.
Now, going back to a force, are you calling a force anything that has a force-carrying particle? And so that's why you said gravity is a force, because there's a graviton associated with it?
So at the fundamental level, everything is quantized. So it doesn't it's not because something has a particle associated with it that it will necessarily be a force. But fundamentally, all fundamental forces will, to my mind, necessarily have a particle as a messenger associated with it, because everything is quantum. And this is all even more true for gravity, because gravity connects to everything. And so if we know that gravity connects with a realm, for instance, electromagnetism, for instance, electrons and other fundamental particles, which are quantum, then gravity has to be quantum as well. You can't just couple something which is fundamentally classical, that satisfies fundamental classical probabilities, with something which satisfies quantum probabilities. Actually, what you need to do is having a grander framework where everything is quantum, and in some limit, some sector may behave classical, but it's only in some limit.
So what do you see as the difficulty in reconciling gravity or general relativity with quantum theory?
So we can do that, and we do that actually on an almost everyday basis in my work, but also in connecting with some people doing observations, when we're dealing with gravity in a not extreme environment. So when we're thinking about how gravity behaves on Earth, in the solar system, even in most of the galaxy, and in most of the universe, actually, we can reconcile gravity with the quantum laws of nature and with the other quantum theories, the quantum theories of the forces, and there's no real issue associated with that. The distinction with gravity and where the problem arises is when we're trying to describe it when the curvature scale is very intense, so in a very extreme environment for gravity. And there, what happens is if we took seriously the quantum laws of probabilities and we applied them to general relativity in those extreme environments, we would end up with some laws of probabilities that stop making sense. And so that doesn't mean that probability doesn't make sense. What it means is that we need a better framework to understanding how to reconcile gravity with those laws of quantum probabilities in those extreme environments. So we don't have access to all of the information, all of the description of how gravity behaves. So if you imagine that you are working with some laws of probabilities, and at the end of the day, the outcome is not what you predicted, it must mean that something else must go on. Now, for gravity, it's not like we've been in an extreme region in the universe, for instance, at the center of a black hole, or for instance, at the very beginning of the Big Bang, and tested gravity and the laws of probability there to be able to say that they don't work. That's not what we have done. Already, according to Einstein's theory of general relativity, when I use the standard laws of quantum probabilities associated with it, I end up with outcomes which simply don't make sense. For instance, you can imagine that typically when you add probabilities, I have a probability for something to happen, I have a probability for something else to happen. When I add things up, I cannot end up with an outcome that has more than 100% probability to happen. But when we take general relativity and we're trying to apply the laws of quantum probability at the very center of the black hole, or, for instance, at the very beginning of the universe, very close to the Big Bang, I seem to be able to end up with outcomes which would have more than 100% probability to happen, or sometimes have a negative probability to happen, or a complex probability to happen. And that simply tells me that I am missing something. I am not summing up all my probabilities given all the configuration that I'm allowing myself properly. Something is missing. And I need to understand gravity better. I need to understand how to go beyond the description of gravity using general relativity to being able to better appreciate how to reconcile my laws of quantum probability with my description of gravity in those extreme environments.
To stay informed in an ever-evolving landscape, I see The Economist as a wellspring of insightful analysis and in-depth reporting on the various topics we explore here and beyond. The Economist's commitment to rigorous journalism means you get a clear picture of the world's most significant developments, whether it's in scientific innovation or the shifting tectonic plates of global politics. The Economist provides comprehensive coverage that goes beyond the headlines. What sets The Economist apart is their ability to make complex issues accessible and engaging, much like we strive to do in this podcast. If you're passionate about expanding your knowledge and gaining a deeper understanding of the forces that shape our world, then I highly recommend subscribing to The Economist. It's an investment into intellectual growth, one that you won't regret. As a listener of TOE, you get a special 20% off discount. Now you can enjoy The Economist and all it has to offer for less. Head over to their website, www.economist.com/TOE, T-O-E, to get started. Thanks for tuning in, and now back to our explorations of the mysteries of the universe.